of a series. And our series is called From Dream to Destiny. From Dream to Destiny. Because, and I'm going to catch you up real quick. I'm not going to spend much time backtracking. But everyone has a dream that God has for your life. Every single person, not just you that are here, every person outside of this, even if they're not saved yet, God has a dream for their life. And usually, many times, he's already revealed that dream to them. Some haven't, he hasn't revealed the dream. But every single person, God has a dream for your life. And secondary, God has a destiny. How many of you believe that this morning? God has a destiny, a purpose for each and every one of you that are in here this morning. He has a specific purpose and destiny for each and every one of you. And that's what we've been talking about, how to get from dream to destiny. Because many people never fulfill the destiny that God has on their life. They're living in the dream instead of living in the destiny. And there's usually one reason. There's usually one word to describe why they never make it to that destiny. You want to know what it is? How many of you remember what that word was? It starts with a C. Character. Character. And we've been looking at the life of Joseph. At 17, Joseph got a dream. He actually got two dreams from God. At 17, he got two dreams from God. And if you remember in our story, the problem was at 17, he wasn't even humble enough to handle the dream. There is no way he would have been humble enough to handle the destiny that that dream included. Because the destiny was for him to be second in command in all of Egypt. And at 17, he couldn't even handle the dream. How would he have handled being in charge of that many people? So God had to take him to school. And that's what we've been looking at. God had to take him through some series of character development, we're going to call it. Character test. He went into school so that God could build his character. Because once his character was strong, he'd be able to handle the destiny that God had for his life. And we're not much different than Joseph. God is constantly working on our character because he wants our character to be strong so that the gifts and talents that he's deposited in you can be carried upon that character. If it's not, it's going to end up going to waste. So we've been looking at Joseph and the dream, getting from dream to destiny. Now, let me tell you where we're at in our story. For those of you that may not have been here, how many of you know that Joseph's brothers, what? Hated his guy. They hated Joseph. They hated him. And the Bible says they couldn't even talk peaceably to him. So one day, and this was last week, one day all the brothers went out and they were tending the flock and their father sent Joseph out to go check on the brothers. Now the brothers saw him coming because he had this special coat on. And so all the brothers saw him coming. They're like, hey. And this is what they literally said. This is not my interpretation. They said, here comes that dreamer. Here comes that dreamer now. And you know what they said? Let's kill him. Let's kill him. And we talked about this last week. I'm sure all of you have had fights with your brothers, maybe your sister. Maybe you're even mad at him. Did you ever want to literally kill him? Well, that's what was going on here. My kids were talking. We were talking, yesterday? And I grew up with... I'm the middle of two brothers. There were seven or eight in our family, but I had a brother 2 years older and 2 years younger. And I was telling him how we used to fight. Man, my brothers and I, we used to fight. We pushed one of them through a window. We were fighting in the bedroom and pushed him through a window. And it stopped the fight really quick because then dad came in. And we weren't saved, so it was okay to lie, okay? It wasn't okay to lie. But dad came in and it was like, we're already in trouble for breaking the window, okay? We'd be in even more trouble for fighting and breaking the window, okay? So a ball hit the window. That's how it broke, okay? But I was talking with my kids, man. My brothers and I fought, man. When we fought, but there was some unwritten rule that we had. You couldn't punch each other in the face. I guess we were all just kind of conceited at that time in life. I don't know what it was. But we fought. But we never had that I'm going to kill him. I want to kill him. His brothers must have had such a disdain for him to the point that they were like, let's kill him. So if you know the story, Joseph comes walking up, they grab him, and they were literally going to kill him, and they threw him in a pit, but the oldest brother, Reuben, said, let's just throw him in the pit for now, because Reuben had this plan. He's like, later on, I'm going to go out and get him out of the pit and bring him back home. So they threw him in the pit, but then Reuben went somewhere, and then these travelers were coming by, these Ishmaelites were coming by, and they thought, why should we kill him? Let's make some money off our brother. So they got their brother out of the pit and sold him as a slave to these Ishmaelites. And that's where we are in our story. Now, I told you last week, and I told you when I read the Bible, I do this oftentimes. I put myself in somebody's place. When I'm reading a story, I'm like, how would I react if I was Joseph? How would I react if I was David? And I told you during this next couple of weeks, do that in this story. Put yourself in Joseph's spot. And see the character that God's trying to develop in Joseph, and see if it's not some of the characteristics God's trying to get into us or some of the things that God is trying to take out of us. Amen? So put yourself in this story. Are you ready? Here we go. We're in Genesis chapter 39. Oh, I got my wrong one here. Hold on a second. I always have the scriptures up here because that way I don't have to pull glasses on and off. So here we are, Genesis 39, verse 1. Now let me get back to my notes. Here we go. Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. So this guy Potiphar owns a house and everything, so he's buying Joseph as a slave. Verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. I got to pause there for a minute. You've got to make that connection this morning. This is one of the key points this morning. You've got to make this connection. It doesn't just say, and the Lord was with them, blah, 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 blah. It doesn't just say, and he was a successful man, blah, 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 blah. Watch, there's a connection here that you've got to see this connection. It says the Lord was with him, and he was a successful man, and he prospered. He prospered. He was successful. Why? Because the Lord was with him. That's so key, and you got to catch that, and you'll catch it because it's going to be repeated. Let me back up verse 2. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw, what? That the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. Again, watch this. Potiphar is not a believer. This guy's not even a believer. His boss, the guy he's working for, he's not a believer. Even this unbeliever saw that God was with this young man and that everything this young man did, God blessed. That everything he did, it prospered and it was successful. Why? Because God was with him. And this unbeliever even spotted that. You know, that can happen with you and I. And it should be happening with you and I. In your workplace, wherever you go, man, your boss should be saying, and even if he doesn't know God, maybe he's like, I don't know what it is. But man, since you've come to work here, things have changed. There's a peace in this building. There's a peace in this office. There's a peace here. Our profits are up. Your employer should be seeing that when you're at work in their place. If God is with you, you're going to be successful and prosper. Now let's read on, verse 4. So Joseph found favor in his sight, and he served him. Then Potiphar made him overseer of his house and all that he had to put under his authority. And so it was from the time that he had made him overseer of his house and all that he had that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field. Watch this, verse 6. Thus he left all that he had in Joseph's hand. And he did not know what he had except for the bread which he ate. So he's like not even worried about it. He didn't even know what he had except for the bread that he ate. Now Joseph, watch this part. Now Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. You have no trouble putting yourself in the story now, do you? It's like I read that. I'm like, yeah, I can put myself in there. Yeah. Listen, now here's we're gonna pause there for a second, but here's what I want you to get out of some of this. You got to see that connection. The master was an unbeliever, but the Lord was with him. The Lord was with Joseph, and he prospered. He was successful. The Lord was with him, and he prospered, and he was successful. Listen to me for a second. That's a powerful statement. That is a powerful statement. He's in Potiphar's house, and Potiphar makes him second in command. Potiphar says, man, there's nobody better in this house other than me. Potiphar says, man, this guy is in charge. It's almost as if Potiphar said, Joseph, here, just run the whole thing. Just run the whole thing. And it said Potiphar didn't even know what he had. He just came to breakfast, lunch, dinner, and enjoyed his life, knowing Joseph was running the whole thing because God was with him and he was successful. Now later on in our story, we're not going to look at this morning, but later on, Joseph is unjustly put in prison. How many of you know this story? He's unjustly put in prison, but here's what happens while he's in prison. The same exact thing. The same exact thing happens to Joseph when he's put in prison. He's put in prison, and the prison keeper notices that the Lord is with them. Now the prison guard, the guy who oversees the prison, says, "You know what, Joseph? God is with you. You just run the whole thing. You just run." A prisoner gets to run the whole prison because this prison keeper saw that the Lord was with him. By the end of our story, Pharaoh makes Joseph second in command of all of Egypt. Look at this verse when he was in prison. Genesis 39, verse 23. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything. Listen, this is a prisoner. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority. Watch this. Because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper. Whatever he did. Now, come on. How many of you watch TV? How many of you watch some prison movies? I don't know about what you're watching, but any prison movie I've ever seen, it's like you'd never let the prisoners take charge, okay? You would never let the prisoners. But yet, this prison keeper saw that God was with Joseph, and he's just like, "Hey, prisoner, come here. You run the whole jail." You heard that saying, the prisoners have taken over? The prison keeper just let him take over because God was with him. Now, here we go. I want you to see this. Whatever he did prospered. He was successful. How many of you would like that? Come on. How many of you would like to have that said? How many of you would like that about your life? That whatever you do, it prospers. Whatever you do, now let me rephrase it though. Whatever you do, whatever you put your hand to, the Lord makes it prosper. Man, I don't know about you, but I'm reading this story and I'm thinking, I'd like that. I'd like that. Man, I'd like the Lord to be with me so much that whatever I do, prosper. Whatever I do, I'm successful in. So this morning, if you're taking notes, and you should be, write this down. I've got four simple keys to being successful and prosperous in everything. Listen to me. In everything you do, you can be successful and prosperous in your job, in your finances, watch me, in your health, in your marriage, in relationships. Come on, who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want that this morning? So I've got four keys to success. If you're taking notes, here's the first one. It should be on the back of the screen. The key to success is the presence of the Lord. The key to success is the presence of the Lord. Listen, this wasn't in my notes this morning, but there was a point in worship, from beginning to end too, but there was a point in worship where I could really feel the presence of the Lord in this place. You see, that's what we're looking for. That's what we're searching for. And that is a key to success. That is a key to success. The key to success is the presence of the Lord. Did you see how many times in our story it said that the Lord was with him and he prospered? That the Lord was with him and he was successful? It's in there throughout that story. Prosperity. Now, here's what you need to get. Because in the regular translation, it uses the word prosperity. Prosperity. Can I tell you something this morning? Prosperity is not a bad word, okay? It's not a bad word, and I'm not going to get into all that, but we know that the word is that it's been abused in some ways, you know, that it's been taken advantage of and preached incorrectly and different things, and I really don't want to go down that road, because what I really want you to get is the problem with all of that, because it's been abused, because it was misunderstood, because of the abuse, all of us, most Christians, we've actually pulled back from the biblical understanding of prosperity. Because of the teachings that went out, because of all that went on, Christians today have pulled back from a biblical understanding of prosperity. And I want you to understand this morning, God wants to prosper you. God wants to prosper you. He wants to make you successful in this life. Some people think, well, yeah, he wants me, I'll be blessed in heaven. No. God wants to bless you in this life. He wants to prosper you now in your marriage, in your health, in your job, in your family, in your finances, in all of those areas of your life. He wants to prosper you. Watch this. God wants to prosper you so that through you, he can prosper others. God wants to bless you so that through you, he can bless others. It really is that simple. The words prosper, prosperity, they're throughout the Bible. They're all over the place in the Word of God. God wants to prosper you. So get rid of that mindset. In fact, say this with me. God wants to prosper me. Amen. He does. That's his goal. Let me give you the Hebrew definition of prosper. Watch this. It means to push forward. To prosper means to push, and literally, Not just, it means literally to push forward. One of the times it's used in the Bible, one of the times is when the Spirit, it says the Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson to defeat his enemies. But it said the Spirit of the Lord came upon him to push him forward in victory. Come on, how many of you want to be pushed forward into victory? I do. And that's the definition. That's the definition. To push forward. To push forward. Man, is it okay if God pushes you forward in your marriage? In your finances? In your career? Come on. It is. That's what God wants to do. He wants to push us. I almost get this picture of God behind us, you know, just kind of pushing you forward, pushing you forward. And you're like, okay, God. He wants to prosper you. He wants to push every one of us. Now, the key to prosperity is the presence of God. Why? Why is that the key? Watch this. Because God never, never, never fails. God never fails. So watch this. So if we walk with God, if we stay in his presence, if we go where he goes, if we do what he does, if we say what he says, guess what? We're going to prosper. We're going to prosper. Because listen, whenever you're involved in whatever God's involved in, it's not going to fail. It is not going to fail. Let me see how I wrote that. If God's in it, it's not going to fail. So get involved in what God's doing. And you're going to prosper. You're going to succeed. You can't fail. You can't fail as long as you're involved in what God is in. The Bible says that Cain went out from the presence of God. The Bible says that Cain went out from. You can go out from the presence. It's just if God is saying, I'm going one way. And Cain said, no, I'm going the other way. I'm going the other way. If you walk with God, if you stay in his presence, you will prosper. You will be blessed. Walk with God. You will be successful. You will prosper. Let me give you a few verses to show you that. Genesis 26, 12 and 13. Watch this. Then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year 100-fold. And the Lord what? Blessed him. Now watch this, verse 13. The man began to prosper, and he continued prospering until he became very prosperous. How many of you get the point there? Do you think God wants you to prosper? I think that's pretty clear. He prospered. He was prospering, and he was prosperous. God wants to prosper you. You got it, okay? Deuteronomy 29:9. Watch this. Therefore, keep the words of this covenant and do them, that you may prosper in what? In what? All that you do. It didn't just say, just spiritually, just, you know. No, in all that you do, in all that you do. 2 Kings 18:7. Watch this. The Lord was with him, and he prospered where? Wherever he went. In other words, in all that you do, wherever you go, God wants to prosper you. 3 John verse 2. Beloved, I pray that you may what? Prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. So God wants to prosper you in all things. He wants to prosper you in your health, and he wants to prosper you spiritually in your soul. God wants to prosper us. God wants to push us forward in all things. The key to prospering is the presence of the Lord. Listen. Even an unbeliever like Potiphar saw that the presence of the Lord brought a blessing with it, caused Joseph to prosper and all of Potiphar's house. Even an unbeliever saw that. So the key to prospering is the presence of the Lord. So you're thinking, okay, Troy, I got it. You can chill out. You can relax. The key to prospering is the presence of the Lord. But, okay, Troy, so what is the key to the presence of the Lord then? Okay, Troy, I got that. That's good. But what's the key to the presence of the Lord? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to give you that one. Here's point number two. The key to the presence of the Lord, this is going to seem so simple, but just let me unpack this. The key to the presence of the Lord is obedience. Obedience. Let me give you a couple of verses, and then we'll jump into this. 2 Chronicles 17:13. Now the Lord was with, so the Lord is with this guy, the Lord is with Jehoshaphat, because what? Because he walked in the former ways of his father David, because he was obedient, because he was obedient. 1 Samuel 18:14, watch this. And David behaved wisely in all his ways, and what? And the Lord was with him. He behaved, he was obedient, and the Lord was with him. Now listen for a minute up here. We know that David didn't do everything right, did he? The Bible tells us, the Bible's pretty clear. David didn't necessarily do everything right. But when David messed up, he would always repent, and he'd come back to the Lord, and he would humble himself. And God would graciously forgive him and put him back on track. But David obeyed the Lord. He obeyed them. Watch this one. This is 1 Samuel 18:12. Now Saul was king at this time. Saul was afraid of David. Why? Because the Lord was what? Was with him. The presence of the Lord was with him. But the presence of the Lord had departed from Saul. Why was Saul afraid of David? Because the Lord was with him. Your enemies, listen to me, your enemies will be afraid of you when they see that the Lord is with you. Why was the Lord with David? Because he obeyed. Why did the Lord depart from Saul? Because he disobeyed. One more verse on this one. Deuteronomy 11, verse 26 to 28. Behold, I set before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, watch this, there's a catch to this blessing. The blessing, if you what? If you obey. So it doesn't just come automatically. He says, choose this day. He's telling you and I, he's telling us to make a choice. But even in making that choice, the blessing will come if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today. And the curse will come if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God. He says, man, if you will just simply obey, I'll prosper you. I'll make you successful. There's a blessing in that. But if you're not going to obey, well, you can figure that out yourself, okay? You can figure that out yourself. But he says, man, listen, just obey. And the funny thing about that is God has actually given you a choice. He you and I, all of us, he's like, choose you this day. Hey, you got a choice. Obey me and be blessed, or disobey and face the consequences. It's your choice. That's what God says. It is your choice. Now, listen, listen, I want you to get this, okay? Because I got to be careful here. I don't want you, this not, obeying God is not about works. This is not about works. Listen, we need to, I believe in, how many believe in grace? We are saved by grace. Absolutely, no doubt about it, we're saved by grace. I believe in grace, but I also believe in obedience, okay? I believe in grace, you're saved by grace, your sins are wiped away, but listen, I believe in obedience. If you want to succeed on this earth, you're going to have to obey God. You're going to have to obey God. And if you obey and walk with God, you will walk in success. It doesn't mean, listen to me, it doesn't mean everything will go right for you. It doesn't mean you won't have problems. It doesn't mean you won't have storms. It just means that God will take you through those storms, watch this, successfully. Successfully. That's what it means. That means when you go through a storm, I was thinking of your dad, and your car gets recalled, you'll come out better on the other end of it. You could get in a car accident, and your car could get totaled, and you come out better. You come out better. We had an older Jaguar, a 1996. It was really nice Jaguar. It was a really nice car. And we actually had put it up for sale. And we weren't getting really many bites on it, but it was a beautiful car, abandoned posh. I'm driving down the road with the for sale sign, and somebody T-bones the car, hits me in the side. By the time the insurance was done, we got twice what we were trying to sell for it. We got twice. And when he hit me, I thought, oh, God, I'm trying to sell the car, and I'll never be able to sell it. I'm whining, and God's like, I got this. I got this. Listen, when you're walking in his presence, even the things, even the storms you go through, he will take you through them successfully. It's not that you won't have them. It's just that he'll get you through them successfully. That's what God is about. That's what walking with God means. Job 36:11-12. Watch this. If they obey and serve him, serve God, they shall spend their days in what? In prosperity, and their years in pleasure. But if they do not obey, I mean, it's getting pretty clear, right? They shall perish by the sword, and they shall die without knowledge. Proverbs 28:13. He who covers his sins will not what? Prosper. In other words, he who disobeys will not prosper. But whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. The key to prospering is the presence of the Lord. The key to the presence of the Lord is obedience. It's obedience. So if you're out there this morning, now you're thinking, okay, Troy, I want all that. I want all that. And listen, I want to obey God, Troy. I want to obey God. But Troy, I just struggle in that. Troy, what is the key to obedience? So what's the key to obedience, Troy? Here's point number three. You ready? The key to obedience is faith. Now, I'm going to explain this one because that might sound odd to you. The key to obedience is faith. Now, I want you to think about it this way, and I'll get around to more modern terms, but why does a farmer plant seed? Because he believes, doesn't he? He has faith, right? He believes. He's obedient in planting seed because he has faith or because he believes that seed is going to bring a harvest. So behind his obedience is faith. Is faith. Listen, most of you, you get in your car and you push down on the gas pedal and you haven't got a clue of how that works, do you? But by faith, man, you're pushing on that gas pedal. Some of you are pushing too hard, okay? But you're pushing on that gas pedal, but you have faith that that car is going to move, don't you? You have faith. Listen, some of us have more faith in our hot water heater at home than we do in our God. You do. Some of you have more faith in your hot, and let me prove it to you. When you first go to that hot water faucet and you turn it on, when you first go to it and turn it on, what happens? What do you get? Cold water, don't you? It's like you turn on the hot water faucet and you get cold water. But you have faith, don't you? Because otherwise you'd be like, oh, you'd walk away, right? But you turn that hot water faucet on and you have faith because cold water's coming out, but you still have faith. And you do what? You just wait. Man, we had a house. I could have swore that hot water heater was like three doors down. Man, you turn that thing on and you could go write a book and come back. But listen, you have faith. Man, you turn that hot water faucet on and you wait. And you wait. Sometimes, I believe most of us have more faith in our hot water heater than we have in our God. We're not willing to wait. We're not willing to wait. We turn that thing on and we will wait. We don't really believe. And what it tells me is this. We say we believe. We say we have faith. But we really, I capitalize really in my notes. We don't really believe that there are rewards and consequences for obeying and disobeying God. We don't really believe that. Because if we really did believe it, we'd just simply obey. If we really believed God's word, we would simply obey. Most of the time we think things, it just doesn't matter. It'll be all right. Watch this, and I'm going to teach you something here. The reason children obey or disobey is because they realize or they believe they'll be rewarded for obedience and disciplined for disobedience. Let me give you a scripture on that one if you're thinking, what? Ephesians 6, 1 through 3. Children, what? Obey. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with a promise that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. Hey, can you get rid of that scripture just for a second? What is the reward for obedience? That's what everybody thinks. That's what everybody thinks. Sorry, babe. You should know me better than that, okay? Of all people. That's only partially correct. Did you notice that? In the verse, you can put it back up if you want. The reward for obedience, many people would just say, oh, that you get to live long on this earth. No, watch this. The reward for obedience is that it may be well with you. I mean, if it's not well with you, I don't know if you really want to live long life anyway, right? It's just my own thought. But listen, the reward for obedience is that it'll go well with you. And that means that you'll prosper and that you'll be successful and you'll have long life. And you'll have long life, but that's what obedience brings. Now, here's the part I want to get to. How many of you have ever been in a store and you've wanted to spank a kid in the store? Yeah, and listen, now wait a minute. Okay, some of you got your hands up. Good, I am not alone. I love that, okay? Listen, but now let me go further. You've been in a store and you wanted to spank a kid in the store and it wasn't your kid. Thank you. Good. I'm glad I'm not alone on that, okay? Because I don't want somebody tweeting, Pastor Troy likes to spank kids in stores, okay? Do not Facebook or tweet that, okay? Listen, I think we've all been there. And watch this. The Bible says in Proverbs 23, he who spanks his child delivers his soul from hell. He delivers his soul from hell. You guys want to go get the Sunday school and bring them on in? We could do that, okay? Listen now. Now, here's why I'm sharing this with you. They will obey. Your children will obey when they have faith, okay? When they have faith, when they believe that their obedience will be rewarded, or old days, not so much today it seems like, when they believe, when they have faith that their disobedience will be disciplined. Listen, when they have that kind of faith, when they have that kind of belief, guess what? They're gonna obey. They are gonna obey. I think there's a whole lot of parents out there that need to work on putting a little more faith into their kids. And you can quote that one, okay? And you can figure it out if you're not sure. Now, back to us. If you believed, if you really believe what I'm saying, man, listen, if you believe, and you're looking at Joseph's life, if you believe you work, if you believe that if you work hard for your employer, God will bless you, then you'd work hard for him, without question. But the problem in our society today is too many people think, listen, when I get a better job, when I work for a better boss, then I'm going to work hard. Listen, you'll never get a better job. You'll never have a better boss. Why would God give you something when you're not faithful with what you have? God's not going to give you more until you can fulfill the requirements for what you have. If you're not faithful where you are, why would God give you more? And so many people think that way. But Joseph wasn't like, man, this Potiphar, he's not even a believer. Why should I work for him? Joseph worked for them. Let me give you the scripture. Colossians 3, verses 22 to 25. Watch this. Bondservants, that's you and I to our employers, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as man pleasers, but in sincerity of heart, fearing God. And whatever you do, do it heartily as what? As to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from who? Knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward. Knowing from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. But he who does wrong will be repaid for what he has done, and there is no partiality. Listen, you and I work for God. Joseph seemed to get this, and the minute he started working for God, everything he did was blessed. Everything he touched prospered. He was successful in all of that. And I want to get that through to you, because so many times we think, when I get that good job. No, be faithful right where you're at, right where you're at right now. Listen, I want you to see this next verse, and it's in Hebrews. And it's really an interesting verse, but it's talking about the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt and they're going into the promised land. So watch this. Hebrews 3, verses 18 and 19. And to whom did he swear? He's talking to them. And to whom did he swear that they would not enter into his rest, not enter into the promised land, but to those who did not obey. So to those who did not obey, they weren't going to enter into the promised land. That's what the verse is saying. But to whom did he swear that they would not enter into his rest, but to those who did not obey. Now watch this, verse 19. So we see that they could not enter in because of what? Unbelief. Now, when I read that verse, I didn't expect that last word. And it really, I don't know why, but when I read it, it shouldn't read that way. How many of you would agree with me? To me, it should read, and to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey. So we see that they could not enter in because of, it should be disobedience, huh? Shouldn't it? It should have been disobedience, but it says, no, they couldn't enter in because of unbelief. Because they didn't believe, they didn't obey. Because they didn't believe, they didn't obey. Watch this. Faith produces obedience. Now listen for a minute. It's going to get tough. We say we're believers. We say we have faith. Man, if that was so, if that really was true, there'd be no issue with obedience to God's word. There'd be no issue to everything God says. If we really had faith, if we really did believe, that faith would produce obedience, and there would be not a single issue with obedience to what God has said. There'd be no issue. Forgiveness? Forgiveness of the person that wronged you? No issue. Generosity? Tithing? No issue. Complete obedience. Honoring, no issue. Putting other people first, no issue. Because we're obedient, because faith. Prayer, church, Bible, it's not an issue. Faith produces obedience. So if we say we're a people of faith, if we say we're a people that believe, then it should be showing up in our lives. And I want to challenge you on that. Now, I'm going to move on. I could do this all morning, but I won't. This will be my last one, I promise. Okay, Troy, So I thought I had faith. What's the key to having faith? So what is the key to having faith? Here's the last one. And I could keep going. There could be five. I could give you six more keys to each one, but I won't. The key to faith is hearing the word. Hearing the word. The key to faith is hearing the word of God. Now that one was hard for me to say, because I really want to say the key to faith is doing the word of God. That's what I want to say, Because I believe in doing. How many of you believe in doing? And actually, that's the obedience part. The obedience part is in the doing. And I believe in doing. But according to God's word, what produces faith is what? Hearing. That's just, I don't know. What produces faith is hearing. Let me give you the verse, Romans 10:17. Most of you will know it. So then faith comes by doing. So faith comes by what? By hearing. And hearing what? The word of God. So how does faith come? By hearing the word of God. By hearing the word of God. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. By listening to it. How many of you listen to the word of God? My daughter Micah is reading through the Bible, but a lot of times it's on her phone and she's putting it on and listening to it. You hear the word of God by listening to it. At church, most of you right now, you're hearing the word of God. You're hearing the word of God. You hear the word of God by reading it, by memorizing it. And we talk about this often here, and I'll try not to get off on it, but we are so trying to get the word of God in you. You need to have the word of God in you. And I could go on and on, but I'm going to stop there. Listen, faith comes by hearing it, by hearing it. This word has the power to change your life. And obedience and faith and believing have to come from hearing first. I can make that real simple. My kids didn't obey without hearing what to obey, right? Your kids aren't going to obey unless you tell them, unless they hear what to obey. We don't believe without hearing what to believe. We don't have faith. We don't have faith without hearing who to have faith in, right? That starts right here. Hearing God's word is so important to all of this, to everything that we're sharing this morning, to being about being successful and prosperous. It all starts right here. It starts here with hearing the word of God. Now listen, this is the part I said might get hard. Hearing God's word is so important. How many of you think the enemy knows that? Now listen to me. This is just my own numbers. I'll bet 90% of you this morning struggle with either reading the Bible or church attendance. And I know I'm preaching to the choir because you guys are all here. This is a message for the people that aren't here this morning, okay? 50% probably struggle with both. Listen, the enemy, the devil knows. The devil knows how key this is. He knows. He knows how key this is. I just don't have time to read, Pastor Troy. I just don't have time to read the Bible. It's too hard to understand. It's too hard for me to understand. Don't ever say this to God. It's boring. And let me just say, this is not in my notes. If you really think the Bible is boring, I don't know what you're reading, okay? And man, I can give you some stories that you'll read in the Bible. You'll be like, wow, I didn't know that was in there. The Bible is not boring. Anybody who's ever said that has never read the Bible, okay? The Bible is not boring. Well, I've tried to read it. I just can't listen. No. Listen, the other thing, I can't come to church. I can't come to church. I got a cold. Now listen, I'm trying to be really nice. I got a cold. I worked all week. I got this paper cut right here on my finger. Watch this one, please. Just go with it. My uncle's in town. My family member's in town. I can't come to church. Listen to me for just a second. You'd be surprised. I think you would be surprised what would happen if you said to your brother, your family member, or your friend who's out of town, if you said to them, hey, we go to church on Sunday mornings, and we'd love for you to come along. Man, I think you would be surprised what might happen. I really do. But I think we take the easy route too many times. And when unsaved family members are in town, we just choose not to go to church. And so you know what that unsaved family member is thinking? It must not be that important. It must not be that important. Listen, when you do that, when you will stop and just say, hey, we go to church. We go to church on Sunday morning, and we would love for you to come along. Listen, two things happen. Your faith will be built up. Your faith will rise up in you. And number two, they'll think, wow, they really do. Here's the key word. They really do believe. They really do believe in this Jesus. Maybe I should check it out. Listen, your faith is going to be built up and their life could be changed. And you're thinking, well, it could also offend them. It could, but guess what? Probably not. And the worst they could say is no. Seriously. Think about it. When next time you have, the worst they could say is no. And then you know what you say? You say, okay, but we're going to church, but we'll meet you for lunch after church, and we'll even buy you lunch. That's all you do. If they say no, you don't. You're going to church, and you start hitting them over. No, you're just like, okay, well, hey, we'll meet you for lunch. But you don't say, okay, I'll just stay home too then. No, man, I'm telling you, I think this would change people's lives. But listen, I don't know how I got off on that, but your enemy, the devil, wants to keep you from hearing because he knows. He knows faith comes by hearing. So if he can keep you out of church, if he can keep you out of the word, he's going to keep you from being successful and prosperous. Because that is the first key. That is the first key. Joseph went through some character building tests so that in the end, he would be successful and watch this and fulfill the destiny that God had on his life. And I can't wait to get to the end of our story, because if you don't know it, that destiny that Joseph fulfills is incredible. And he does it. And he does it, but not without going through some character tests, not without going through some character building. But he's faithful in doing it, and he comes out on top, fulfilling the destiny that God has for him. Question this morning. I'm wrapping it up right now. Do you want to be successful? How many want to be successful this morning? Do you want to go from a dream to walking in the destiny that God has for you? Come on, man. I do. The key to success is the presence of the Lord. The key to the presence of the Lord is obedience. And the key to obedience is faith. And the key to faith is hearing the word. Listen to me. This is me talking to you. I want your marriage to prosper. And I want you to be successful in your career, in your job. I want your family to prosper. I want your kids to prosper. I want your health. Man, I want your health to prosper. And I want you to prosper spiritually. Like Joseph. I want you to be successful like Joseph was. And fulfill God's destiny for your life. That's my prayer. That's the prayer of this pastor for all of you this morning. Because I can look out at you this morning and I can see that God's placed a dream in each and every one of you. But a dream is good enough in and of itself. God puts the dream in there to drive you to the destiny. And if you never reach the destiny that God has for you, that's just a shame. And it's not God's fault. Amen. It's not God's fault. He wants to prosper you and make you successful.